forget thy throne crown brow. Oh, lead me to Calvary. Oh, lest I forget Gethsemane. Oh, lest I forget thy Gethsemane. Oh, lest I forget Gethsemane. Oh, lest I forget thine agony. Oh, lest I forget thy love for me. To thee, daily my cross for thee, even thy cup, oh, even thy cup of grief to share. Thou hast borne all for all together now, lest I forget Gethsemane.
Lest I forget, lest I forget.
word of prayer.
Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, as we have seen, bless, we forgot what you have done there at Calvary for each one of us, Lord. So, Lord, we know what we have done for us, as who were people with sin, but by your love, you came to death there at Calvary for each one of us, Lord. So, Lord, we cannot forget what you have done for each one of us, Lord. And that's why, Lord, we are gathered here to say thank you, Lord, for what you have done for each one of us, to save us, Lord, to love us, Lord. The Lord, if we are here, Lord, is to bring glory and honor to your name, Lord, for everything that you are doing among us, Lord. Lord, we want also to commit this service in your hand. We want the Holy Spirit to come and take control of each one of us, Lord. Lord, we pray for the preaching of the word. Lord, use the men who will come and stand here, because in every age you have been using the men. Lord, we want also to pray for song leader. We want to pray for the musician. We want to pray for each one of us, Lord. Lord, you know our need, and we know we have a father who cares for his children, Lord. So we commit everything in your hand. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Just turn to your neighbor and give them a handshake and welcome them into the house of the Lord. Amen. It's a privilege to gather once again in his presence and worship him together and praise him together. Amen. Look and live. Amen. Hallelujah. This next song says, I have a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. The message unto you I'll give. 'Tis recorded in his word. Hallelujah. It is only that you look and live. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's sing that together and worship him today. Oh, I have a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. Oh, my friend, for you. Oh, 'tis recorded in his word. Hallelujah. It is all that you look and live, look and live, my brother, live. Oh, look to Jesus now and live. Oh, 'tis recorded in his word. Oh, it is all that you look and live. I've a message. I've a message for lost love. Hallelujah. MS. Oh, my friend, for you. 'Tis a message. 'Tis a message. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus say, and I know it. Now look and live. Look and live. Jesus, now and live. Oh, Everlasting arms. Amen. Safe and secure from all alarms. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad to be leaning on those everlasting arms? Amen. Amen. Just before we invite the deacons forward to pray for the tithe and offerings, I'd like to sing a song, probably a special. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Amen. The mountain's too high, the valley's too wide. Amen. and Brother Moses will help me with this song. Amen. Again. Oh, I thought I could do a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all day long. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk. Oh, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. You know the mountain is too high and the valley is too wide. Down on my knees, I've learned to stand. Lord, I can't even walk Oh Lord, I can't even walk. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Can't even walk without you holding my hand. Amen. Sometimes the mountain is too high and the valleys are too wide. Amen. Ask Brother Paul to come forward and bless the tithe and offerings.
Amen. You appreciate the song this morning, this afternoon. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. We've got it now. Praise God. Amen. You appreciate the song. Amen. It's the story of our life, isn't it? Amen. Amen. We can't even walk, amen, without the mighty one, amen, holding our hand. Hallelujah. And we don't want to take another step knowing that we haven't got a hold of his hand. Amen. Let's just bow our hearts. Heavenly Father, we, Lord, just privileged people, Father. Lord, to think that you would have something special reserved for your bride in the end time, Lord. Father, even as the song was expressed, Lord, these songs just don't come, Father or God, Lord, by education or by, Lord, learnings, Father. Lord, these songs come by experience, Lord. And with that experience, oh God, there's, Father or God, a reality, Father. And Lord, you are the great reality of our lives. Lord, you're the King of our peace, Lord. Lord, you're the giver of every good gift, Father. And we just come and approach you, Lord Jesus, Father, because we've got nowhere else to go, Father. Lord, Father, we look to the left and we just see disappointment, Lord. We look to the right, Father, and there's destruction, Father. Lord, there's only one place to look, Father. Lord, and that is to keep our eyes upon you, Lord, and the very giver of strength, Lord, our great, oh God, El Shaddai, Father. We just thank you today that you are the giver of strength, Lord. You are the provider of all of our needs. Father, you continually provide for us, Lord. And we're so grateful that we can approach you, Lord, and come to the altar this afternoon, Father. And Lord, not just laying, Lord, the things that you've placed in our hands, Father. Lord, because you just don't want, Father, oh God, that, Lord. But you want all, Father. You want us all, Father, oh God. You want our heart to be upon this great altar, Father, that you would, Father, receive it, Lord. And we're just so grateful, Father, Lord, as we bring the tithes, the offerings into your hand. We just ask for a blessing upon it, Lord, that it will be used for your kingdom. You know the needs of this body here, Father, in Perth. You know, Lord, that we're looking and we're searching and we're desiring a place, Father. Lord, as we wander and look and find, Lord, oh God, we want to do one thing today, Father, and that is place it into your hands, because you know what you're doing, Father. Lord, the mountain is too high, Father. The valley is too wide, Lord. But nothing is impossible for you, oh God. So we just lay it into your hands, into your care and keeping, Lord, as we place ourselves, our lives into your hands today, Father. May you have the preeminence in the preaching of the word, Father, in everything that's been done here this day, Father. Lord, oh God, may we have another great experience with you, Father. Lord, another breaking of your bread, Father, and the opening of your word, Father. And Lord, oh God, the deliverance of souls, Father. We just thank you now as we commit all these things into your hands, as we continue to worship you, Lord. We do so, Father, in spirit and in truth. We ask all these things in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Are we still happy to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. I didn't get a good response there. We'll try that again. Are we still happy to be in the house of the Lord today? Hallelujah. That's better. Let's just stand together again to our feet and worship the Lord once again. Amen. All glory be to God. He lifted me up, KC. Amen. All glory be to God. to God, He lifted me up. He lifted me up, I know. He reached down His hand and He lifted me up. And that's why I love. Oh, glory be to God. Oh, glory be to God. He lifted me up. He lifted me up, I know. He reached down His hand and He lifted me up. And that's why I love Him. Oh, I love Him. I love Him more and more. Oh, I love Him more and more. And when I stand upon the other shore, I'll praise Him more and more. I love Him. I love Him more and more. Oh, I love Him more and more. Oh, and when I stand upon the other shore, oh, glory be to God. Too sure if you believe what we are singing. Want to sing that with a bit more revelation? Oh, glory be to God, He lifted me up. Amen. He reached down His hand and He lifted me up, and that's why we all love Him today. Amen. So we'll sing that together once again. Amen. Oh, glory be to God. Lifted me up. Amen. That's why I love Him more. As we enter this time of worship, amen, we sing the song, Keep Me True, Lord Jesus, Keep Me True. There is a race that I must run, and there are victories to be won. Amen. There are few. word to be true. Keep me true, keep me. Isn't that your prayer? Just worship Him now. Keep me true, Jesus. Keep me true, keep me. Oh Lord Jesus, keep me. There is a race, there's a race that I must run. There are victories to be you. Oh, give me power every hour to. Oh, keep me true, keep me. Lord Jesus, keep me true. Keep me true, keep me. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, because there's a race, there's a race that I must run. There are victories to be. Now give me power every hour. Oh, there is a race, there's a race that I must run. There are victories to be. Oh, give me power every. One more time. Oh, there is a race, there's a race that I must run. There to be. Now give me power every. Keep me true, Lord Jesus. Oh, keep me true. Keep. Just worship Him now. Raise your voice and worship Him. Lord, keep me true. Keep me. Lord Jesus, keep. Because there is a race, there's a race that I must run, and there are victories to be. Now give me power every word. Oh, there is a race, there's a race that I must run. There to be you. Now give me power every word to. Hallelujah. Amen. There is a race to run. There are victories to win. We just pray for that power to be true. Amen. Amen. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. Amen. KG. Let's just worship Him together. Amen. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for eternity long and find there is none like you. There is none like you. Just worship Him now. Oh, there is none like you. There is none like you, Lord. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search, oh, I could search for eternity long and find there is none like you. Just raise your hands now. There is none, there is none like. There's none like our God. No one else can touch me. Oh, no one else can touch my heart like you do. Oh, I could could search for all eternity long and find there is none like, for the last time, there is none like you. Oh, there is none like you. There is none like you, Lord. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. I could search for all eternity. Oh, I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like. I could search for all eternity, just the voices. I could search for all eternity long and find. There is none. Give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Blessed be his holy name. There is none like Jesus. We could search all eternity. We still can't find anyone like him. Amen. Hallelujah. Emmanuel. Emmanuel. Amen. His name is called Emmanuel. As we prepare our hearts for the coming of the word. Amen. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, his name is called, his name is called. Just worship him now. Oh, Emmanuel, God in us. Oh, God with us, revealed in us. His name is called, his name is called, Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Just raise your voice now and sing Emmanuel. Oh, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, Emmanuel. His name is called, his name is called, Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, for the last time. Oh, Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Oh, Emmanuel, his name, his name is called Emmanuel. Just give the Lord some praise this afternoon. Just worship him. His name is called Emmanuel, God with us, revealed in us. Hallelujah. Amen. Just to close the walk with thee. Amen. As we invite the pastor to come forward. Amen. Just a closer walk with thee. Oh, granted, Jesus is my plea. Oh, daily walking close to thee. Jesus, keep me. Oh, Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied. Oh, I'll be satisfied as long. Oh, as I walk, let me walk close to thee. Just a closer, just a closer walk with thee. Oh, granted, Jesus, granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. If I falter, Lord, who cares? Oh, now who with me? Who with me my burden share? Oh, none but, hallelujah, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer, just a closer walk with thee. Oh, granted, Jesus, granted, Jesus is my plea. Oh, daily walking, daily walking close to thee. When my feeble life is old, oh, now sing it to him now. Time for me will be no more. Oh, time. This is my prayer today. Lord, guide me gently. Guide me gently, safely, oh. Granted, Jesus, granted, Jesus is my plea. Oh, daily walking, daily walking close to thee. continue in this time of worship as we prepare for the pastor to come forward. Amen. Oh, my loving brother, when the world is on fire, don't you want God's bosom to be your pillow? Amen. Comes forward. Amen. Blessed be, blessed be, blessed be your name. Blessed be, oh, blessed, so blessed be.
Thank you, musicians. Amen. would like to greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Certainly is a wonderful thing to be in the house of the Lord. If we could just open our Bibles to the book of Revelation, chapter 8. Book of Revelation, chapter 8. We'd like to appreciate the musicians and the song leader for giving us a bit of time to come forward, but all the same, we want to appreciate you for your patience. Revelation chapter 8, and we start from verse 13. So we're just reading one scripture from that chapter, which is verse 13. And then we... the Bible reads, "And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound." May the Lord add blessing to the reading of his word. You may be seated. And so we would like to take an aspect from the Feast of Trumpets, and I would like to speak on the great end time contest. The great end time contest. We just took an aspect last week, and we're able to just show by the word the day that we are living in and the kind of attack that the enemy has placed upon the people. And we want to take another aspect as well from that same message of the Feast of Trumpets. And we want to talk about the great end time contest, very related to the subject last week, but it's just a different angle. But all the same, it's a great subject that will definitely take a series to just be able to try and touch on various aspects of it. But there's one thing that stands obvious, is that the first four trumpets are slightly different from the last three trumpets of the book of Revelation. As we read chapter 8, chapter 9, going to 10, we start to realize that the first four are really affecting the earth, are affecting the waters, they are affecting the trees and everything like that, but they are not really affecting the people directly. But when the four trumpets are done and you get to the fifth, sixth, and seventh, there is like an interlude there where there is an angel that flies through the midst of heaven and he cries with a loud voice and he cries three times, "Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound." In other words, there's an interlude there to show that the other remaining three trumpets are slightly different from the other three, and it goes directly to the inhabitants of the earth and cries out, "Woe, woe, woe." And those are the three woes. And the prophet is very clear about what that is. And the prophet says those are the three world wars. The first world war from 1914 to 1918. The second world war that ended, I believe, in 1945, somewhere around there. And then we have what we expect to be the third world war, which is, we believe also is that battle that ends it. And so we know the prophet makes it clear. That's what he refers to it right there. He says those are the three wars. And so for us, the two have already taken place, the First World War, the Second World War, and we come, we are in between the Second World War and the Third World War. Amen. So Revelation chapter 19, when we go to verse 13, and we read from that portion of the scripture, "And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet." So now this is the sixth trumpet to be sounded. "Loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates." And the four angels were loosed,
which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year, for to slay the third part of men. And the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000, and I heard the number of them. And thus I saw the horses in the vision, and them that sat on them, having the breastplates of fire, and of jacinth, and of brimstone, and the heads of the horses were as the heads of lions, and out of their mouths issued fire, and smoke, and brimstone. By these three was the third part of men killed, by the fire, by the smoke, and by the brimstone, which issued out of their mouths. For their power is in their mouth and in their tails, for their tails were like unto serpents, and had heads, and with them they do hurt. And the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk. Neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. So when we go to Revelation chapter 9, the sixth angel with the sixth trumpet sounds, and he sounds, he looses the four angels that were holding back. And when he sounds, there is a mighty army that is released from the river Euphrates. And the number thereof is 200,000. Amen. And he says, I heard the number of them. Amen. But as you notice, when you get to verse 20 and verse 21, you start to realize that the effect of these great horses that had these unique heads and tails like snakes, that had such an effect upon the people to hurt the people, you start to realize that there were plagues that were coming upon the people as a result of their actions. And they were so judging the people as a result of their actions, but even though the people could see the judgment of these, they still did not repent. They continued to worship devils and worship idols made of gold and silver and brass and stone and wood. And they did also not repent of their evil acts of murders or sorceries or their fornication or their thefts. In other words, even though they were affected by these things, they still did not take their time to stop and look and say, maybe we need to change how we do and try and change how they approached things. They still continued in their evil. And so we know that Revelation is the book of symbols. Amen. And so these things are symbols, like we read and did mention last time, that these things are representations of something. They are symbols of something. And the prophet makes it very clear in the message, the Feast of Trumpets, and he says on paragraph 160, they wasn't natural horses. They breathed fire. They had breastplates of jasper and had tails. And the end of the tail looked like a serpent, a snake's head on the end of it, stinging. See, it was spiritual horses. So these were just symbols, but they were spiritual horses, spiritual devils, chargers that had been bound in Euphrates all these years, supernatural devils. What was it? The old Roman Empire being revived. So the prophet makes it very clear. It's devils that were bound and not allowed to cross the river Euphrates. But at this point in time, they are loosed. Amen. But let's continue. The old Roman Empire being revived, the persecution of the Jews. They had been bound for 2,000 years at the river Euphrates. Can't cross to the promise. A religious sect that was trying to get to the other side of Euphrates, you know, come through Eden, but they were bound there. 200,000 devils of persecution. And notice what happens under that sixth trumpet, which we have just read. They were turned loose on the Jews, the persecution of the Jews, supernatural devils, nearly 2,000 years, then loosed by Stalin, Hitler, upon the Jews. You say, well, that isn't Roman. It's the same spirit. They done the same things they did to the Christians in the old pagan Roman days. Now watch the natural Israel and the spiritual church now as we separate it here, turned loose upon the Jews. So Revelation chapter 9, starting from verse 13, going on down to the end of the chapter, is referring to spirits that were bound by the river Euphrates. In other words, there were spirits that were held back to not affect, amen, God's people. But yet, at the time that was appointed, they were loosed. Amen. The devils were loosed. And the prophet says, these are spiritual horses. They are spiritual devils. Amen. But devils use people. Amen. In other words, there were spirits that were let loose. And they went to persecute. They were the old Roman spirits. And what did the Roman Empire do? It persecuted the church, just like it did in the beginning. The prophet, in another portion, he says, who was General Titus that went and besieged Jerusalem and massacred the people there until blood was flowing on the streets? It only took the people, the disciples, that had taken heed to the voice of our Lord, that he had spoken to them, that when you see these things happening, then flee Jerusalem. Amen. So it was the message that Christ himself in the flesh had given to his disciples that made them escape the judgment that came by Titus. Amen. But it was still the same murderous spirit, genocidal spirit. We know that it was the same spirit that when they heard that there is a king of the Jews that has been promised to come upon the earth and is probably about 2 years right now, he knew that if he tried to find the particular child, he might not find the particular child. So with the genocidal spirit upon him, the Roman spirit, he went after all the children that were of the Jews that were 2 years and below and killed all of them. So it's a genocidal spirit. It's a murderous spirit that wages war against God's chosen people. Amen. And so it may have been in Stalin. It may have been in Mussolini, who was in Italy at that time. It may have been in Hitler. But all the same, it was the same murderous spirit, which is the same spirit, the old Roman spirit, to come and stand against God's chosen people. Amen. And so that's what is symbolized in Revelation chapter 19. And the prophet continues on paragraph 163 and he says, there is that Roman Empire bound there. And he asks the question, by what? The ecclesiastical powers, which Rome, pagan Rome, became papal Rome and was bound there in its traditions of Christian. What part of Christian and superstition it had of Rome putting together all this worship of women and all this other kind of stuff and Christmas days and holidays and things, it's been bound with that tradition that it cannot let loose because it's against Christian principles. Still the same ungodly pagan spirit, and that spirit caught into the nations of the world according to the prophecies of Ezekiel and the rest of them. And which portion of scripture do we find in Ezekiel? We find the angels that had the weapons of slaughter that are told to hold back until the angel that had the inkhorn by the side goes into the city and marks all those that were crying and sighing for the abominations that were being done in the city. Amen. And so we start to realize that this is exactly the same thing that has been prophesied, that represented by that angel that was wearing linen, that had the ink on by the side and was placing a mark on their foreheads to mark those that were sighing. In other words, these were people who were not part of the sins, who were not part of the idolatry, who were not part of the rebellion against God that was happening in the city. And so therefore they received a mark on their forehead, a symbol of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And it is only those people, like we spoke last week, that escaped the effect of the angels that had been held back. Amen. And the prophet is showing us there that when you look at that, it's not just coming and it's just a murderous spirit that is killing and destroying God's chosen people. But it is also a lot of things in it. It is a teaching. It is a doctrine. It is coming with beliefs, making people to worship idols, changing the way the people worship their God. Amen. Just like we read in the book of Revelation, it says they repented not their worship of idols made of gold and silver and wood. In other words, these were spirits that using flattery, using deception, coming with religious teachings, were coming upon the people and turning the people from the true worship of God until people have got a religious spirit about them and they just approach God in a religious sense. Amen. And he says there that it was these spirits put together, the worship of women and all this other kind of stuff and Christmas days and holidays. In other words, when you look at this quote, you just start to see the spirit that we have today. You just see the spirit that we have today. It's been amplified, but it's still the same spirit. Amen. You hardly see a billboard without a badly dressed woman on it. You hardly see and approach anything without an elevation. Amen. And trying to establish what I think, I'll try and pronounce it well. This word is always difficult for me. Matriarchy, a society that is a matriarchy. Amen. In other words, that elevates the women and lifts them above and causes the women to be worshipped. But we know what that symbolizes. It is also an elevation of the church above the true word of God. So it's just natural types, the natural types, the spiritual. But what we see there is an elevation of a church instead of people worshiping the one true God. But what happens in the spirit is also manifested in the natural as well. Amen. But where are these spirits coming from? These are the spirits that have been unleashed, that were bound by the river Euphrates, murderous spirits that come and that have such a hatred upon the chosen of God. Amen. And there is a reason why they hate that, because the prophet makes it very clear on paragraph 199 of that message. And he says there, in explaining the Jews, how that yes, they had missed their Messiah. Yes, they were not worshiping God in the way that God had revealed himself. He had come on the flesh, but they had denied their Messiah. But all the same, he says, watch that natural, what it did to them Jews. That was a people that held to the laws of God. No matter how many churches raised up, what else, they was blinded to Christ and held to that law. And God gave them robes, every one of them, because they went down in martyrdom. They were blinded for our sake. Here now, the church that knows nothing but the Bible, regardless of ecclesiastical system, denomination, they know nothing about it. It's all foreign to them. They know him and him alone. That's the trait that the Jews had. Yes, they had denied the Messiah. Yes, they had not accepted their Messiah, but they were God's chosen people. And they had stuck to what they believed. They were blinded for a reason. Amen. So that the Gentiles could be grafted in. And as a result of their blindness, they stuck to what they knew, which was the laws of Moses, which was the keeping of the Passover, which was the laws and the word and the traditions that they had received from their fathers. And no matter where they went in the world, they still carried their Star of David. They still had their Sabbath observations. They still had their cultures. They still had their teachings. They still kept their language. They still kept their books. They still kept their teachings. They still were able to believe, as wrong as they were in not accepting the Messiah, but yet they believed that they were a chosen people. They would always refer to themselves as the children of Abraham, Abraham who was given the promise of God, and they conducted themselves as such. Amen. And the people could see the blessing of God upon them, and they were hardworking, they were businessmen, they had all these things, and they spread throughout the world. Amen. But they still kept the law, as the prophet says there. They kept the law. Amen. And they were, and in their nature, they are like some people today. Amen. They are like some people today. Those people, no matter what teaching comes up, remember the Jews went all over the world. They mingled with so many cultures. They mingled with so many teachings. They mingled with so many traditions. Yet they remained true to the law of Moses. Amen. And they are like a group of people today. Those people, no matter what ecclesiastical teachings have come up, amen, no matter what denominations have come up, they know nothing about it. They only know one thing. They know him and him alone. And if they were sticking to the law of Moses, sticking to the traditions of their father, even though they were blinded, yet sticking to the law of Moses, to the tradition of their fathers, to the word that they had believed and had received, passed on from generation to generation. And it was that sticking to that word that made them different, that made these spirits angry and came after them. The same murderous spirits will also come after this other group that chooses not to be affected by ecclesiastical teachings, that chooses to be not affected by denominations. That same group will also experience the same persecution. But there is only one difference in it. These ones were persecuted in the natural. We know that the dictators drove them to concentration camps. They burnt them. They gassed them. They shot them. They performed experiments upon them. They did all kinds of evil things upon them. Why? Because they did not see them as equal human beings. The hatred was so much that the desire was to completely finish them off from the face of the earth. Amen. But that was in the natural. Upon God's chosen people, the 12 tribes of Israel, they wanted to completely finish them. But there is a spiritual seed of God as well that also chooses to not be influenced by any teachings, by any cultures, by any denomination, by any of these things that are affecting the world. They choose to know only him. The one that has been told to them from time to time, from the prophets of old to the scriptures, to this day, they choose to know only one, which is him. The same also will have to face persecution. The same also will have to be affected by the same spirits. But how are they affected? They will also be affected. Obviously, the same spirits will come to try and affect them and attack them with the same Roman spirits. Amen. Which the prophet has listed there. They will come with these superstitions. They will come with these traditions. They will come with this worship of women. They will come with all this other kind of stuff, with all these holy days and everything else. They will come after them. And when they do not get the result, we know what's coming. We know what's coming. It will even come in the natural. Amen. Where they persecute the church as well. But in their coming, in their coming, they will not be able to touch a certain group of people. Why? Because the spirits were not allowed to touch all those that had received the mark on their foreheads. They could go and touch everyone else who was in the city, except for a group of people that had received the mark on their foreheads. And the prophet continues. I think we read paragraph 163, and then we went to paragraph 199, and I believe we are now at paragraph 201. The prophet is referring here to what people do when they see the move of God on the earth. He says, people today are somewhat like Peter and them was up on the Mount of Transfiguration. They got all enthused when they seen the supernatural deed and said, we will make one church of the prophets and one to Moses. And that's the way the people, the Pentecostals, did. They said, we will make one assembly of God and one church of God and one oneness and one two-ness and so forth like that. But while he was yet speaking, Jehovah cried out, this is my beloved son, who is the word? Hear ye him. See, he is the word. Now, if we go back to what we said, they have chosen, this group of people chooses to know nothing, no ecclesiastical system, no denomination. They choose to know nothing but him. Everything else is foreign to them but him. So there's a group of people that hear so many things, that are in contact with so many teachings, with so many cultures, with so many approaches, but that group of people chooses to only know one thing, which is him. And when we say him, who do we mean? We mean Christ. Praise the Lord. And so the people that escape these things are the people that choose to know only him. And the prophet breaks it down now. How is it that we know him, which is Christ? He says, the thing of it is, and he's referring to this day that we are living in, where God pours out his Holy Spirit, where God sends out the working of miracles, signs and wonders upon the face of the earth. And instead of the people focusing on the word, even in the ministry of the prophet of our day, focusing on the word, people develop a denominational mindset. And instead of the people assembling and gathering around the Holy Ghost so that the Holy Ghost can be able to bring them into union with him, real, true, perfect union with him, the people don't stick around for that. They get excited, like Peter got excited on Mount Transfiguration. Oh, this feeling is so good. Why don't we make three tabernacles here? One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Why don't we stay in this place? Amen. The prophet is saying that's the same thing that the people will do today. They will create a denomination. They will create a gathering. They will create this and that, but they will miss it. But whilst Peter was still talking that, oh, let's make three booths here, then the voice came and he said that this is my beloved son. Who is the beloved son? The prophet says the word. He was the word made flesh. Hear ye him. See, he is the word. In other words, don't be caught up in the experience. Don't be caught up in the excitement. Don't say, oh, this is good, so we stay here. Listen to the word. The word will take you where you want to go. Don't camp around an experience. Don't camp around something that is good for today. But the word, the Holy Spirit, the word itself will take you where you need to be. Hear ye him. Why? Because he is the word. He is the word. The one thing that you need is the word. Praise the Lord. Why? Because when you mix the word with something else, you make the word of God with of no effect. They had the word. They had received the word. But the word had no power in their lives because they had mixed it with their own traditions and they made it of no non-effect. They had mixed the word of God with their own teachings. They had mixed the word of God with their own approach, with their own preferences and interpretations to it. And the word lost its power. So there's one thing that makes the word lose its power is when man injects his own thoughts on the word. Then the word, even though the word is there, but when it's been diluted by the thoughts of man, then the word loses its power. Amen. But the cry on Mount Transfiguration was, don't develop your own idea. Don't assemble around this experience. Amen. Hear ye him. Who is him? The word. Praise the Lord. But while this group down here, Feast of Trumpets 207, while this group down here has got 2,000 bound at the river Euphrates, and has been bound for 2,000 years, also that church has bound the Holy Ghost for nearly 2,000 years. Under martyrdom, back there, and under the church ages, it's been bound, not at the river Euphrates, but at the door of creeds and dogmas. That the Holy Spirit can't work in the church because of man-made systems. But she is going to be liberated. She is coming back. That's what the Bible said. And those two meet one another on the battlegrounds. Lucifer and Michael again. Like in the beginning, they have been bound for 2,000 years. Almost 2,000 years. Not exactly 2,000, because the Romans kept on going. Titus in AD 96, on down like that. Kill the Jews, the Romans. Who was it killed the Jews? Who was Titus? A Roman general. I hope we are starting to get the sense here. That there is a contest between two. Lucifer and Michael. Amen. And Michael is standing with God's elect people. And Lucifer is using spirits. Demonic spirits is using the Roman Empire, which later on turns to Papal Empire, but it's still the same. It's still the same spirit that has evolved from an imperial empire to a religious organization, but it's still the same murderous spirits. Amen. And the same spirits that have stood against the Jews, who were prepared to only observe the law and the word that they had received, is the same spirit that will also come after God's elect as well. Still the same. And how has it bound the church and stopped the church from progressing? The revelation of the seals. What do you see? Murder. What do you see? Deception. What do you see? Politics. What do you see? Playing with the economies, control of the world economies, deception, wrong teaching. Amen. All these spirits, who are they standing against? They have already stood against the true church, which is the elect of God, and has bound the church and pulled the church back so much so that the church should have been somewhere, but it could not get there. Why couldn't it get there? Because this same spirit was standing against the progress, was standing against the perfection of the church. Amen. And so the church on the day of Pentecost received the true baptism of the Holy Ghost. Christ was manifest and made manifest in the flesh of his disciples. But they could not go far before the same spirit came and started to murder and played its part. We know the emperors that came and took over the church and declared themselves head of the church and head of the state. It was the same spirit. And therefore, they injected their own pagan beliefs in there, their own celebrations in there, their own teachings in there, their own interpretations there. And this teaching spread throughout the world. And it was holding the church back. The church could not move forward. But God had to do something to set the church free. Amen. And so therefore the Reformation started. Amen. God started to send his messengers. Justification, the just shall live by faith. Sanctification, the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And the restoration that we have received today, the full word. And the prophet is saying there in that court, that throughout these 2,000 years, it's been bound. But what has been binding the church? It has been at the door of creeds and dogmas. This is what has bound the church. It has been creeds and dogmas. And the Holy Spirit can't work in the church because of man-made systems. But she is going to be liberated. She is going to come back. That's what the Bible said. Amen. What did the Bible say? Those two again that fought in the beginning, Lucifer and Michael, are coming back again and fight again after almost 2,000 years. Why? Because Michael has got to come and set his people free that are bound by these creeds and dogmas. And how does he do that? If we can go to paragraph 232. The prophet says, notice here is a great thing. Look, oh my, the Holy Spirit has been bound by the denominations. All these 2,000 years, we find out it has. Now notice the Sabbaths, 7 Sabbaths, they couldn't get all the way out. And the prophet teaches us about the gap between the feast, the Feast of the Trumpets and the Day of Pentecost. Praise the Lord. And we start to see that those feasts were actually showing us a type of what the Lord would do in our day. And the prophet shows us that gap of the 7 Sabbaths, because they would celebrate it on the 50th day, was actually a representation of the 7 church ages. Praise the Lord. And it is at that end of the 7 church ages that he starts to open himself and reveal the atonement to the church, which is Christ the Word. Which is exactly the same thing that he does as well. After that feast, then comes the Feast of Atonement. And he's got to reveal the atonement to them. Just like he also has to reveal the atonement to the true church, the elect seed. But what is the atonement to the elect seed, the Gentile church? It is Christ, the Word, that he reveals. And he says there in the Feast of Trumpets, paragraph 243, just exactly a similar quote from 232. He says, the Holy Spirit has been bound by these denominational rivers for almost 2,000 years, but is to be loosed in the evening time by the evening time message. The Holy Spirit back in the church again, Christ himself revealed in human flesh in the evening time. He said he promised it. So the church has not been able to move. The church has not been able to make Christ manifest in the flesh. The Holy Spirit has not been able to be perfectly united with his seed because of teachings, creeds, and dogmas and the traditions of men. Are we together? So the same spirits that stand against the elect of God in the natural seed of Abraham have been the same spirits that stand against the spiritual seed of Abraham. The children of Abraham, spiritually speaking, those that have the faith of Abraham. I'm sure you understand what we are saying. But it's still the same spirit. The same spirit that goes to God's natural chosen seed, which is the Jews, is the same spirit that goes also to God's spiritual chosen seed, which is the Gentile bride. And how does he go after the Gentile bride? By bringing amongst them the same pagan worship that was in Rome, the worship of human flesh, the worship of idols, the observation of days, bringing in culture and traditions in the worship of the true God. And when those things are mixed with the word of God, then the church is rendered powerless. The church is bound. And the prophet says, is bound by these rivers. It's not the river Euphrates. Amen. The physical, natural river there now. But it is the rivers of the denominational teaching. It is that rivers of the denominational system that is binding the church. But God has promised, amen, that after 2,000 years, almost 2,000 years, that it is going to be loosed in the evening time. And how is the Holy Spirit going to be loosed in the evening time? It is going to be loosed by the evening time message. The Holy Spirit back in the church again. Christ himself revealed in human flesh in the evening time. He said it, he promised it. So there's a great battle going on. It is a battle between Michael and Lucifer. Lucifer still wants to hold the people back with his wrong teachings, with his traditions, with everything else that holds the church back, the thinking and the teachings of men. But Michael is going to come and fight for the people. And how is he going to fight for the setting free of the people? He is going to come with a message. There is one thing that releases the Holy Spirit. There is one thing that brings a perfect union between the Holy Spirit and the elect of God. It is a message of the evening time. Amen. Just like the natural seed of Israel, God has used the persecution. God has used the First World War. You know what happened in the First World War? That portion of Israel was under the Ottoman Empire, which was a Muslim empire. Amen. It was occupied by mainly a Muslim population. But after the First World War, Britain got a hold of it. Remember, they subdivided after the conquest of Germany in the First World War and their allies, which was also the Ottoman Empire. They divided the land and Britain got a hold of Israel, the land. Amen. And so that was a stage there that happened. And it was Britain that handed over by its withdrawal from that place that handed over Israel to the Jews. But it was the Second World War. The First World War gave the land to a sympathetic country that was sympathetic to the Jews. Many of you who know history, they will read about the Balfour Declaration, how that they were saying we have an intention to create a state that is for the Jews. Amen. This is in the First World War. And writing to Jewish advocates about how they were going to help them establish their own state. But we know that it was the Second World War. It was the persecution of the Jews under the dictatorships that pushed the Jews to that land. They were so comfortable wherever they were, they would not have gone back to the land of their promise. But they were forced there by the persecution. They were running away from the torture chambers. They were running away from the persecution in Europe and all over the world, that they were pushed. The prophet says it was the tender hand of Jehovah that pushed them to the promised land. Amen. So all these things happened to push them to that place. But why are they pushed to that place? Because God deals with Israel as a nation. Now, when you mention Israel, especially today with what is happening in the Gaza, it's a very controversial subject. But we are not talking about, because not all Israel is Israel. Amen. Not all Israel is Israel. There's different kinds of Jews. Amen. We are talking about the real true seed of Abraham. Amen. Which we know that at the time appointed, God has gathered them together. There's been a gathering of the people. What do? The trumpets gather the people. And when they've been gathered, why have they been gathered? They've been gathered so that they can be able to observe their atonement. Amen. And what is this atonement that they are going to observe? God has got to send messengers amongst them that will show them that the one that you have denied is exactly the atonement that was for you. And God will have to do that by sending two prophets to them, according to Revelation chapter 11. And these two prophets will preach the message, the same message that has been preached to the Gentile elect seed of God. They will also preach the same and show and reveal the mighty God unveiled before us and show Israel that that was God in flesh that you denied. Just like we've been shown today that God wants to manifest himself in the flesh and he's already been manifested in the flesh before us. And their eyes shall be opened to their atonement. And they shall come to a place of knowledge that we persecuted the righteous one. And they shall cry. But of the millions that are said to be in Israel, only 144,000 true Jews, not Wall Street Jews, not people claiming to be Jews, true seed of God, which God knows to be one of, that these people are of this tribe. These people are of this tribe. 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes as listed in the book of Revelation shall be saved. And those that are saved are the real, true, spiritual Jews that the two prophets are coming for. Out of the millions, only 144 will be able to believe the message of the true prophets, who the prophet says clearly is Moses and Elijah. Praise the Lord. Why? Because it takes the message to open the eyes of the people. And when the eyes of the people are open, then Christ is made plain before us. Then they can come into a perfect union with him because they know what they are uniting with. There is nothing that is now standing between them and God. They have got a perfect understanding, a perfect revelation. Therefore, they can come into a perfect union with Christ, their atonement. Are we together? So, the Holy Spirit will be loosed in the evening time by the evening time message. The Holy Spirit back in the church, Christ himself revealed in human flesh in the evening time. He said, he promised it. My, praise the Lord. Amen. If we could read paragraph 184. The prophet says, someone will say, you say, the church has to go through the persecution for the perfection of it. The blood of Jesus Christ perfects the bride. The atonement, the blood of Jesus Christ perfects the bride. A man who chooses a wife, don't put her through a lot of punishment. She's already found grace. Two, with her. She has found grace with him. He engages to her. And if there is anything, he will keep her from every place to turn her hand. His grace is so great upon them. And so will it be upon the bride. And so is it on the bride. We unworthy creatures, deserving of hell, but his grace holds us through it. Look at how many lost and blind, how many sinners was there in the world the hour I got saved. God saved me for a purpose. And I'm determined by his will to do that purpose. I don't care what anything else goes, I want to do it. God is not going to allow the church to suffer the tribulation. Like others are going to suffer the tribulation. He cannot allow his elect seed to suffer persecution. Why? Because by him choosing them, he has already given them his grace. He cannot allow them to suffer persecution that is going to come through this system. In other words, these spirits cannot affect his people. Why? Because by him choosing them, he has given them and shown them much grace. Amen. And we know how he has chosen them. They were chosen in him from before the foundation of the world. Their names were written in the Lamb's book of life from before the foundation of the world. And so when he sends the evening time message, their names are wound in the evening time message. And so when you hear the evening time message and you believe the message, you hear your name. And when you hear your name and you answer to that call, that's the grace of God upon you. That is the blessed assurance that God is not going to allow you to go into the tribulation. That God is not going to allow you to be tormented by all these spirits that have been set loose upon the earth. Why? Because you were chosen in him. That's all you need to know. That's all you need to know. You cannot suffer persecution. Neither can you have mind battles and say, can I have rapturing faith? Can I be perfected? But it only takes, because it only takes perfect love to get there. Can you ask yourself, how can I be perfected? You see, you've got to be able. Nothing will ever give you the faith to believe in your perfection but the revealed word of the day. But the revealed word of your day. It is the one that shows you the atonement and brings the perfect revelation of what the atonement has done for you. That there is no more sin. Without the message of the hour, you cannot really catch the revelation of the sea of forgetfulness. Without the message of the hour, you cannot catch the revelation of justification, that you are justified as if you have never done it before. So there is a group of people, and this group of people is a special type, a special class of people, an elect of God. They are a seed, spiritually speaking, like the natural seed that is there in the promised land. And that revelation has got to come to that seed. And God has got to send a messenger before them to open the word, to preach justification, to preach sanctification, to preach the baptism of the Holy Ghost, to preach about the opening of the word, and to show them who they are. And it is those people that believe in the revelation that has been given to them for their day, that can be perfected. Why? Because they understand what the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ is. They are not going around looking for some nails, rusted nails. They are not going around looking for some for some chips of wood somewhere. They are not going around looking for that. They know exactly what the word they've believed is, that they are washed by the waters of the word, that they are sanctified by the word, they are made clean by the word, they are perfected by the word. That is what makes them not seek anything else but the word, because they know their perfection, they know rapturing faith, they know their peace, they know their prosperity. They know every promise of God is given to them, but by the word. So they seek a union, not with anything else, but they seek a union with the word. My, praise the Lord. Christ himself revealed in the flesh. And at the same time, now as soon as this church, the bride, is drawn together, she is taken up. And that mystery of the seventh seal, or the seventh seal, the mystery of going, the Jews is called by the mystery of the seventh trumpet. So the Gentile bride is called by the mystery of the seventh seal. The Jews are called by the mystery of the seventh trumpet, which is two prophets. What is the mystery of the seventh trumpet? Is two prophets, Elijah and Moses, and they come back, and there is where the Pentecostals is all mixed up. They are looking for something to happen. The church is done gone. Oh my. Look at the similarities between what God does for the natural seed and what he does for the spiritual seed. Praise the Lord. And they are going to have to receive, just like the seventh trumpet is to the Jews, so is the seventh seal to the Gentile bride. And what is the seventh trumpet message? It is Moses and Elijah. And if it is in the form of a prophet, the seventh trumpet, and it's similar to the seventh seal, what is the seventh seal? It is that message. It is that opening of the word. It is the coming of Christ. How does he come? He comes by the shout. You cannot take away the message from the coming of the Lord. Amen. Why? Because that's how he comes. So in the way he's going to reveal the token, the atonement to Israel, is the same way he's revealing the atonement to the Gentile bride. And how is he doing that? By coming in the highest form of a minister that he can, which is a prophet. To come and open the word and show the people, just like he will show the Jews, that that Christ that you persecuted, that you crucified, was the atonement. He is coming back again, amen, with a message. And what is the message going to say? The same Christ that you received at Pentecost, the one that you have lost, is the same Christ today that you need. Why? Because the faith of the children has got to be restored back to the faith of the fathers. What fathers? Pentecostal fathers. The faith of the Omega bride has got to be restored to the faith of the Alpha bride. Amen. This is what the prophet is saying there. The Pentecostals is all mixed up. The Jews are called by the mystery of the seventh trumpet. And I like the word, the mystery of the seventh trumpet, because there is a lot in there. Just like the mystery of the seventh seal, there is a lot packed right in there. Amen. But it is in that mystery that they are called up by Moses and Elijah. The prophet goes on and he says, and the seventh angel's message under the same trumpet, same everything exactly, the same seal is to call the people, the bride, out of the Pentecostal and world tradition to the genuine atonement, the word. Christ impersonated in his word here, made flesh amongst us. Just like he calls them and shows Israel their atonement, he's doing the same also to the bride by the message, seventh angel's message. He's also showing the Gentile bride their atonement, which is Christ, the impersonated word here, that is flesh, that is made flesh amongst us. We are very familiar with this quote. The messenger of Malachi 4, which is the seventh angel, has got to do two things, according to Malachi 4. Praise the Lord. He will turn the hearts of the children to the fathers. Two, ye will reveal the mysteries of the seven thunders in Revelation 10, which are the revelations contained in the seven seals. It will be these divinely revealed mystery truths that literally turn the hearts of the children to the Pentecostal fathers. This is the unleashing of the Holy Ghost himself. This is what brings the gentle bride to a perfect union with her God. This is the time when Christ is made manifest in the flesh in the end time. How does he do that? He does it first by the first sheaf that is waved before us, that God can come and in tabernacle himself in a sin-born body of a man that has been justified and sanctified and can be so much in him till the people confuse him for the Messiah. Amen. What is God doing? He is showing that when you come into union with this word, this is what becomes of you. Amen. And the first sheaf is waved before the people until the people start to say, I baptize you in the name of William Branham. That William Branham is our Messiah. What was happening? The people got confused by the mystery that God was waving before them, which is a union of his word, which is his message, coming into union with a sin-born body. And God in tabernacling himself in a body of flesh and manifesting his word so much so that the people were confused and thought he was the very Messiah. And that is what he has promised us. There is a group of people that actually believes that they are chosen. There is a group of people that actually deep down in their hearts believes that they are favored of God. There is actually a group of people that no matter what the world throws at them, they believe that they are blessed. There is a group of people that no matter how much they are tempted, they cannot follow the temptation of the world because they are content with the portion that has been given to them. There is a group of people today that believes that they are as eternal as God is eternal. There is a group of people today that believes that even before they were born, they were already blessed. And the old 200,000 demons are there and they are not happy with those people that are going around the world carrying on with the law, carrying on believing that they are the chosen. All this anti-Semitism that we see today, when you get to the core of it, it's because people don't like it when there's a group of people that believes themselves to be chosen. That's the contention of the world with the true seed of Abraham. How dare you walk around believing that you are more blessed than others? How dare you walk around thinking that God is only for you? How dare you walk around thinking just because you are a certain bloodline, just because you are of a certain genetic makeup, you think you are special? And people feel it, brother. They feel it in their hearts. The hatred for the Jews builds up. And brother, people, they want to kill them. They want them off the face of the earth. How dare you believe such things? Guess what? The same hatred is given to that group of people that thinks that they are the eternal seed of God. The same hatred also comes towards that group of people that thinks that they are blessed, that thinks that they are elected, that thinks that their names are in the Lamb's book of life from before the foundation of the world, that thinks that they know their God and they shall do great exploits. And people sit there and listen to you and think, these people think they are very special. But there is a group of people that will not look at how the world is dressing, that will not follow the fashions of the world, that will not follow the entertainments of the world, that will not follow where everyone else is going. And they still, though they are existing in a world with all these things, they still believe they are in their own Goshen. How dare you believe that stuff? You think you are special. You are more special than us. You want to make us feel bad. Then persecution comes. Why does persecution come? Trying to do God a service without being the will of God. Paragraph 173. Notice, God promised in his word that he would choose his bride by his original way. He chose his bridegroom. He foretold it by the prophets and sent a prophet to identify it. The prophet said, standing on the banks of Jordan, behold, they said, you are the Messiah, aren't you? He said, no, I'm not the Messiah. You must be the Messiah. But I'm not him, but he is standing amongst you. They wanted to watch, they were looking at John the Baptist and saying, are you not the Messiah? You must be the Messiah. The things that you speak, you must be. I am not him, but he is standing among you. And his shoes I'm not worthy to loosen. When he comes, he makes himself known. And today, he is standing amongst us in the person of the Holy Ghost, manifesting himself more and more. Coming into his church, making himself known, because him and the bride and the groom will be the same. Making himself known, and one day you see the one that you filled in your heart and see his identification will become personalized before you. Then you and he are one. Hallelujah. You've united by the word, and the word was in the beginning. We'll go back to the beginning, which is God. And that day, you will know that I am in the Father. The Father in me, I in you, and you in me. Hallelujah. We are here. Hallelujah. I'm so glad to see him personifying himself right amongst us and see what he promised for the word. Not what somebody's emotion, singing and jumping and dancing, but by his word, amen, he is making himself known. Those people think they are special. If you hear them talk, you would think they are the only ones that know God. Message people. Compass. You would think they've been to heaven and came down with the notes of how to go up there. And when you talk to people, you start to feel it. Sometimes that feeling is right amongst us, right in the camp. When you just want to feel spiritual and really rejoice and talk about the grace of God in your life, people will be like, ah, this brother, this sister, she thinks she's something. We are all sinners. If you are a sinner, don't say we are all sinners. You see, what's happening? Where is the struggle? People, there is traditions. There is teachings. Old Roman teachings and spirits that are standing in between people and the revealed word, the evening time message. And the people, you see, you cannot see God in yourself when you cannot see God in others. That's where the problem is. To really believe that God has purpose to come and dwell in a vessel of flesh and believe that God can use that sister. God can actually use that brother. There is a block there somewhere. How many people really believe it? Really, truly believe. Don't go outside and start to look at the other brother. That one is a stretch. Can you really believe that God can use you? Can you really believe that you can be one with God? That scripture when he said, I am in the Father in me, ye in me, I in you. When he was saying that, when it says you, can you see your name in there? This is where we are. This is the coming of the message. This is the opening of the seals. What are the seals doing to the bride? It's to show the bride that your names were in the Lamb's book of life from before the foundation of the world. It's to show you, my brother, to show you, my sister, that you are a chosen people. That you were chosen in him. Before you were born, you were chosen in him. To make you believe that perfection is not for somebody else. Perfection is yours. That you can be perfect with all your faults, with all your mistakes, with all your falling, with all your failings, that you can be made perfect. Can you be perfect? How can, you see, people say, how can someone be perfect? How can they be perfect? You believe his word? Are you in union with his word? See, brothers, if we believe this message in a way of, this is a little bit too much, this stuff. It's a little bit too strong for me. I would rather just believe just the Godhead and baptism. But when we get to these things, don't overcomplicate the message. The message is not complicated, brother. Let's just believe the basic things, brother. The Lord will see us through. If it was the basic things, then the angel would not have come with an open book to give us the revelation that is contained in the seven thunders. These things have been given to us, and we need to speak about them time and time again. Amen. Because this is what makes us the message believers. We have not been excited like Peter, who sees the supernatural, gets excited, and wants to create a camp around the supernatural. No, we are the ones that have received and have written, they have received the instruction, hear ye him. Not just the excitement of the supernatural. Yes, a great prophet. Yes, great miracles. Yes, great discernment. Yes, everything like that. But we go beyond that. Hear ye him. God's prophet. Because it's the word that comes out of his mouth that perfects us. We are sanctified by the word. It is the evening time message that perfects us. It is the evening time message that brings us into a perfect union with the Holy Ghost. It is the evening time message that is the applying of the token, so that when the storms, when the death angel comes, it will not enter our home, it will not enter our life, because there is a token there that stands. And it is no longer the chemistry of the blood, it is now the life that was in the blood. The life of Christ in us stands against the judgments of the world. Now we are there. We cannot be looking further, looking to the past, not looking at the present and rushing to look at the future. We are there. We are the people to whom these promises have been given. This is the message that we have received. Brothers and sisters, when we really grasp these things and you hear on the news what is happening in Israel, you don't just run with the news. Whichever side, left or right, you look at that situation through the lenses of the word. And when you see things happening there, you know they are connected to this message. Because the prophet says the same time they were raising the flag and becoming a nation is the same time the angel visited me in the cave and commissioned me. There is a connection between the natural seed of Abraham and the children of the faith of Abraham. Just like the seventh trumpet is to the Jews, so is the seventh seal, the mystery of the opening of the seventh seal. This message came for us. And as we see things reaching a certain point there, look through the lenses of the word and see what the Lord is doing. See where we are. Test your faith. Check your life and see if you are in perfect union with Him. Christ, the same, Hebrews 13:8, the same Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Who is this Melchizedek? Not who was. Who is this Melchizedek? The mighty God unveiled before us. When their eyes were opened, they knew Him. Hallelujah. Who is this masterpiece? What's God's masterpiece? See, we read these messages and we are busy seeing other people. We are seeing the prophet. We are seeing Christ when He came in the flesh. We are seeing the other brothers. We see Martin Luther. We see John Wesley. We see the Pentecostals. Where are you? Where are you? See, don't be bound by these old religious spirits that stops you from believing that you are in this Holy Bible, that you are chosen of God, that you are a special class of people, that you are a prophetic class of people, that you are as eternal as God is eternal, that you are part of the word of God. Amen. And heaven and earth will pass away, but the word of God will never pass away. And by saying that, you are saying you will not pass away. And you start to think like that. You start to process yourself like that. Then the moment you see yourself in that, then sin is nothing to you. The world loses its hold on you because you are attracted by the higher things. The problem is the world has such a grip on you because you are still playing down here. You are still too connected to your natural birth and your natural attributes. But when we lose that connection, the first husband has got to die so that we can get married to the second husband. We need to connect to our spiritual genes. Our spiritual genes, and start to manifest the name. And you cannot disconnect the name from the life because the name is connected to the life. We need to start manifesting Christ. But how can we even start manifesting Christ when we do not believe that we and Christ are one? How can we start to do all these great things when we don't believe that we were chosen to manifest those great things? We are the bride. You are the bride. You are the chosen of God. This message, brothers, is something special. Let's choose to believe it without any reservation. Let's choose to go into it. That's why there's so much criticism for it. It's the old spirits trying to bind you by the denominational rivers so that you don't progress to where you've got to be. But it is these divinely revealed mystery truths that will literally turn the hearts of the children back to their Pentecostal fathers. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that will make our shadows heal the sick. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that will make angels come and give us tips and warnings that don't go there or do this. This thing is going to happen, but don't worry. God is going to take care of you. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that you can be seen in here and tomorrow you are seen there and you haven't been in a plane. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that will make you speak and the things that you speak come and take place. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that will give you a peace that surpasses understanding. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that is the power that helps you to overcome the world. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that makes you love your brother, that makes you love your sister. It is these divinely revealed mystery truths that makes it a joy to you to serve and to live for God. You are not coming to church grudgingly. You are not serving God grudgingly. You do it with joy in your heart because you understand who it is that you are serving. So you don't hesitate to do anything at church. Why? Because you know you are not serving human beings, but Christ in them. Praise the Lord. And when you have come and you have prayed up, you say, Lord, I don't want to hear from men. I don't want to hear from Brother Michael. You are seated there and you know you are hearing from the heavens above. Because that's what the prayer was, that God will speak to you. And brother, when you start to operate in that realm, believing these things that have been revealed to us, doubt starts to move away. Confusion, amnesia starts to move away. You start to see clearer and clearer and clearer. You start to look in the mirror, brother, of God's word, and you start to say, Mommy, that's me. That's me right there. That's me. And when we get to that point, it's unlimited what God will do amongst us. God richly bless you. You may stand on our feet. Praise the Lord. There's a song that you sang before I came. Can I see the song?
Emmanuel, amen.
Christ, why did they crucify Christ? That you being a man, you start to tell us that I am the bread that came down from heaven. Is this not the son of Joseph and Mary? He's telling us he's the bread that came down from heaven. Before Abraham was, I am. Is this not our brother who is saying these things? I and my father are one. That was their biggest problem. And that's why they crucified him, because to them that was blasphemy. But the message that they shall receive will open their eyes to make them see what he was talking about. And to others, it can sound like blasphemy today. But when you have received the message that came by the man who had the spirit of both Moses and Elijah and opened the word, it will cease to be blasphemy. Because you are not saying it boastfully. You are saying it appreciating the grace that has been upon your life, that has been placed upon your life. Isn't it a wonderful thing? The world may not see it the way you see it, but the grace of God will reveal it to you. And that's your overcoming power. They shall overcome even as I overcame. How did he overcome? He had perfect realization, perfect revelation of who he was. Amen.
Emmanuel. His name is called. God with us.
Oh, God with us. Revealed in us. His name is called Emmanuel. Emmanuel.
One more time, Emmanuel.
Oh, Emmanuel, oh, Emmanuel, his name is called Emmanuel, Emmanuel,
God with us.
Oh, God with us, revealed in us. Oh, his name is called Emmanuel,
Amen. Our precious brother, Brother Phil, he has been blessed with these. He's been blessed with these two children. They are twins, a boy and a girl. Praise the Lord. And so this brother is named Jose Winner, and the sister is Julia Queen Esther. Praise the Lord. And so they have been blessed with these twins. They have a son. Our brother has been with us in fellowship for a couple of months now. And this is his mother-in-law. And so she stands here to represent his wife, who's not too well today. We saw them last night, and unfortunately she took sick this morning. But we go ahead with the dedication. Praise the Lord. We have her mom here to stand. Amen, in her place. Praise the Lord. So we receive these babies just like they used to do with the Lord, to bring the children. And this is the family recognizing that these children have been entrusted to them. But it is the Lord's. They are a gift from God to them. And so they bring the kids back to the house of the Lord to ask for God's blessing, to ask for God's guidance, that the same God who gave it to them, who gave these children to them, may also continue to watch over them until they have also a time of their own decision and choose to walk with him, just like the parents have chosen to walk with them. So this is Brother Phil, and he is married to our sister, who we are yet to see. Many of us, some of us we have seen her, but some of us we have to see her when she comes. Her name is Sister Myriad. So we'll pray for our precious brother here, Osir Winner. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we come before you, Father. Lord, with your servants here, the elders of the church, we stand before you, Father, to receive these children, Lord Jesus Christ, and as they used to give them over to you. Father, oh God, but we stand as your servants, Father, and receive these children, Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, and we come and bring them before you, Father, and commit, oh God, here, my brother, Jose Winner, Lord Jesus. We commit him into your hands, and we pray that you bless him. We pray that you watch over him. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you protect him. We pray, Lord Jesus, that your presence may go with him. Father, Lord Jesus, we pray for the father, we pray for the mother, we pray for the home, even the siblings of God, that you may bring a love amongst them. You may bring, Father, your blessings upon them, that, Father, the father may be able to provide for the family, that the fifth gospel in the home, Father, may be able to discern and to minister unto this child, Father, Lord, in the way that he is got to be raised. We thank you, Lord, and as he grows, if you tarry in your coming, may he grow in your grace and come to a time of decision, Father, and ask for your blessing upon him and dedicate him back to you, Father. In the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. And we have our sister here. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, it's all right, sister. It's okay. Praise the Lord. So this is Sister Julia, Queen Esther. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's good. That's good. We are dedicating you, all right? Yeah, all right. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we come with this precious little one. Lord, a child that you have given to our brother, Brother Phil, and his wife, Sister Myriad. Lord Jesus, and we commit her into your hands, Lord Jesus. Lord God of heaven, you've given this child as a blessing, as a gift to our brother and our sister. But they are able to recognize, Lord, that this gift comes from thee. And Lord, like Samson's mother, they bring her back to you. Lord Jesus, and we pray that your presence may continue with her, that you may be with her, Father. Stand with her, O God. Bless her, Father. Protect her, O God. Lord, may your presence be the strongest influence upon her life. May your mercies continue with her. Bless the father, bless the mother. Give them wisdom and discernment, Father, to raise this child the way she ought to be raised. Be with the siblings also, that they may be one beautiful, happy family, being in your presence with the joy of their Lord in their heart. We receive your Father and dedicate your Father back into your hands. Lord, we receive this, our precious sister, Julia Queen Esther, and dedicate her back into your hands. In the mighty name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. We appreciate the Lord. Amen. And raise our little ones in the fear of the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Amen. I don't know if anyone has a good camera. And yeah, the sister needs to see some really good pictures. Brother Mordecai, could you take some pictures? When you say good camera, everyone is like, I'm not too sure if... You've got to nominate sometimes. Yeah, yeah, we're good. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Appreciate the Lord. God bless you. God bless you richly. Amen. God bless you, Mom. You have been blessed. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's sing that song again. Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Thank you, brothers. Thank you, elders.
Emmanuel. Emmanuel. His name is called Emmanuel. God with us. Oh, God with us, revealed in us, His name is called, oh, Emmanuel.
Hallelujah. Everyone blessed. Amen. Just before we dismiss, we just remind you that we have communion this evening, 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock. So we can be back here for 5 o'clock. Ah, yes, and we have food out there too. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's just bow our hearts, shall we, as we just commit ourselves into the hand of the Lord as we depart. We take the blessings that we receive with us. Amen. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're so privileged, Father of God. Lord, when this whole world is just groping in darkness, Father. Lord, searching, Father of God, for a way. Lord, but you, Father, through your sovereign grace, Father, Lord, has given light to us, Father, to see. You've given us your promises, Father, that we may, Lord, rejoice, Father. Oh God, Lord, and realizing there's nothing in us, oh God, that could even achieve anything that you have given us today, Father. Lord, but just your sovereign grace, Lord, that's your love projecting to us, oh God, that is Father, oh God, that love that you loved us with before the foundation of the world. Lord, even as we part from the sanctuary, Father, Lord, may you just bind our hearts together, Lord. And Father, just meditate upon, Lord, this great conflict that we find ourselves in and the great victory in love divine that's been achieved, Father, through the message of the hour. We just thank you now, Lord, and just prepare our hearts for the communion service. Lord, as we come back, Father, oh God, to break the bread, Father, oh God, Lord, that you laid your life down for us, Father. Oh God, you poured out your blood for us, Father. You washed us. Lord and Father, it's just such a special time, Lord. And Father, even the food that's been provided, we just commit it into your hands also, Father. We thank you for this time together, the preaching of the word, how it came in its simplicity and yet so much power with it, Lord. We're so grateful to you, Father, and just ask your blessings now in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.